Yes, so this is episode 2 of Ladybug in Rhino Grasshopper. The last time we looked into, we were setting up a data-driven windrows with real weather data, and we looked into how to run the script, how to bake it, and how to set a certain analysis period. Today we would, I was thinking to go through some of these items in the analysis weather data tab, just to see what can we get out, what initial things we can analyze from the data we have. And then in the next video we would go into more visualization and more environmental analysis. Okay, so I don't want to lose that, so we might need this later, but I will group it and just put it aside for now. This we also don't need at the moment, so let's get rid of it. Okay, now let's just go through. So we already saw the analysis period component, so that should be clear. Then we have branch data. Okay, so this data branch, so what it does, it splits your data in, for example, it splits it in data each day of the year. That means it gives me, it splits the data into 365 branches for each day a branch. So I could actually pick a certain, I could pick a certain day out of this, for example, by using the tree branch item, tree branch component. Could put in the data set, the tree, and then let's add a panel here. And then use and then input or select a branch of one of these days. So let's, for example, for sure there's a more elegant way to do it, but just for the sake of showing it. So that would give me basically, and now I have the temperature here. I'm checking the temperature for each day of the year, and I can choose one branch, the 30th, that's actually the 29th day of the year, because we start with zero as the first day. So the 29th day of the year has these temperatures per hour. Or you can choose each data each month. So if I go here, it will, you can also represent that maybe like this. So it gives me, hopla, that's not what we want. It gives me basically 12 branches for each month of branch. It looks like this. It's like this. So 9 for August, because it's basically January 0. Not sorry, August. Yeah. Oh no, that would be, sorry, October already. So 9 would be October. But then it would, yeah, it so basically gives me the data for each hour in that month. So there's a way to basically separate the data in different portions. So for what is that good? Basically you can then, you don't want to always analyze a whole year, but you want to analyze certain aspects of the data. For example, this is very interesting, because it gives you basically a certain hour of the day for each day, so for each day of the year. Okay, let's, so just for better understanding, if I go in here, it gives you 24 branches, which basically represents the hour of the day. and then each of these branches has 365 data entries, which is basically saying I want to know the temperature for each day of the year at 9 o'clock in the evening. Remember, because we start at zero, so it would be then 9 o'clock in the evening. So if we choose 9 o'clock in the evening, then I get these temperatures for the whole year, for a certain time of the day. I think this is very, very handy. Oh, okay, next component would be average data. That's also interesting. So let's use something different. Let's use humidity. Here you can, as we had in the windrows, you can specify an analysis period. And let's get a panel again. So I shouldn't delete this. We'll need this now every time. Panel is always good to check what's actually in the data. So that's also if it collected any. But so what this does is basically gives you the average for the set you want to, or for the period or aspect you want to have a look at. So this is basically just the hourly data. This is the same as you would get from here. It's just passed through, but I could check the average daily humidity in percentage. It still has this text at the front, but we can get rid of that if we use this tool separate data. So you can input a list, and this would give me the pure text or the numbers, which is quite handy. So we can copy that input here, and then we have our, so we have 365 entries from 0 to 364, and it separates the text from the string. It separates the numbers or the number data from the text. I can do the same with the month, so it gives me the average humidity of the month. And there is more, you can actually change the behavior of that script. This is set to true. Again, there comes the toggle input into play. So it basically adds all the numbers, basically sums up the, yeah, so for each day, you, for example, the average daily humidity percentage would be 78. And then if I sum up the total daily would be then this percentage. If I sum up the whole day for each hour of the day, basically. Next is the cooling days and heating days calculation. So, okay, my understanding of this is that it basically gives you an idea of the degrees you might need to cool or heat your building. It would be how much degrees you might want to need to cool your building in order to reach a certain temperature. But of course, it's a bit abstract, because it depends really on the insulation and the heat gain of a building. More interesting is this one, the wind speed calculator. Yeah, so okay, the wind speed calculator is interesting because, as you know, that wind speeds rise with the height, gain with the height. So if I add my, it basically just calculates how the wind speed would be in 10 meters height, which could be interesting. Let's get this here. Let's go to the end of the list. So we can compare. And I think we might need to add a wind direction here. This is optional, but what is interesting would be the terrain type, because that basically adds a factor depending on where you want to kind of estimate the wind speed. So zero would be city. So I guess because it seems like the wind speed is much lower, that means it probably chooses the wind, the default wind situation as in the city. But I could change that. So let's test it. If I set the data here, 0. Okay, let's try. Yes, so I set suburban, then it increases the wind speed. And if I now choose 4, oh, 4 doesn't exist, sorry, 3, that would be basically the wind speeds on the agricultural, like outside countryside, open field kind of situation. Yeah, so the next would be the adaptive comfort calculator that basically just takes the temperature. Of course, there probably are different ways to use that component, but for example, it can give you a very indicative idea if a space is comfortable or not. Of course, we could then check what kind of day is that, which hour of the day is that. It's either comfortable or not means 1 would be comfortable, 0 would be not. If we compare that with the actual data of the temperature, then we would see that on the day where it's 25 degrees, it's still good. If it's lower, much lower, if it's lower than 21, then it becomes uncomfortable. And if it's higher than 27, I think, then it again becomes too hot. So it gives you a very rough idea about comfort, outdoor comfort or indoor comfort. It depends on how you're gonna use that component. We will go more into detail about outdoor comfort in another video. There are some, well, there's more, of course, to the outdoor comfort calculation. We can look at that in another video, because we will set up a 3D model with and see how we can calculate the outdoor comfort in a 3D model. But there are also some kind of funny ways to calculate stuff. The ladybug clothing function. It will tells you on how much clothes you should wear each day of the year, which is kind of absurd. You can again use the analysis period, maximum clothing. I don't know even what it means, but an optional number representing the maximum clothing value that someone will wear on the coldest day of the outdoor air temperature input. The default is set to 1. Which corresponds to a 3-piece suit. So basically 1 means full clothes. Don't know what it means to wear 0.5% clothes. Maybe a trouser and a shirt, long trousers and a shirt. I don't know. But yeah, a lot of things you can may or may not calculate. Yeah, so there are many more other components here which you can have a look at. I think most of them are actually self-explanatory. For example, I didn't ever use, for example, the sunset and sunrise calculator, but just feel free to open it. It will always tell you what you need to input. So anything with underline here at the front means that is mandatory to input. So in that case you need the location. Then you can either add the hour of the day or a period. Let's, for example, just add a number. So it will give you, that is actually good if you're a photographer. It gives you basically, it will tell you when the sun will go come, when the sun will rise on a certain areas. Of course, it's based on the weather data, so it based on this, on the location you put in. If you want to put in your own location, then you need to go to the weather data and download the weather file. If you don't know how to do that, please check the first episode of this series. Okay, so that's basically it. Again, just play with it. That will give you the most, the best way to learn is to actually just try it and just read what are the different options. Okay, I think in the next, I think that's again enough for this episode, and then in the next one we will go more into visualization of weather data again with sun paths, the Ladybug monthly bar chart, that's interesting. So there's a lot of interesting stuff to see. Okay, that's it.